Right, so good morning, everybody. Welcome to lecture 36 of quantum mechanics, part one. In the previous lectures, I've been talking about angular momentum. Right, so what we have seen so far is that if you look at angular momentum, there are two operators, L squared and LZ, which we diagonalize. And when I say that we diagonalize, I just use this expression here. So let me explain this a little bit. So I said we diagonalize the operators LZ and L square. So what does this expression mean? Right, and you will hear this very often if you look at scientific papers, research papers, and talks and such things. So you see that we are working in some basis, right? This basis of states that we found, you can just write this as LM. And the coefficients of this state can be written as in this way, right? And then, cat theta, cat phi. So from theta is equal to 0 to pi, and phi is equal to 0 to 2 pi. So this is these are our states, right? Lm, and what are the eigenvalues of these states? The Lz operator has an eigenvalue m h bar Lm. L square has an eigenvalue h bar square L times L plus 1. Right now. And where L and M are integers, and so L goes like 0, 1, 2, whatever, till infinity. And for a given value of L, M goes from minus L to plus L in steps of 1. So when we say diagonalize some operator, right? What does that mean? So here, these states become my basis states, right? So if I want to write down the state for any arbitrary state in my Hilbert space, psi, right? These are my basis states. How will I write down any arbitrary state in my angular momentum Hilbert space? That means for my rotating particle, I have some state. How do I express any arbitrary state? So an arbitrary state will be a sum over the basis vectors, right? So you'll take the basis vectors and you'll take some linear superposition of these basis vectors, right? And this is these coefficients are the tell you what the superposition is looks like. So this is an arbitrary state of system with rotational symmetry. Okay, right? So the way that, for instance, if you look at a spin 1/2 system, so if you have a Hamiltonian 0, 1, minus 1, something, what are the basis states? The basis states are the up states and the down states, right? and then we can write any state, any arbitrary state, as a superposition of these things. Right? Or if our Hamiltonian is, let's say, plus p squared by 2m. So this is for a free particle. What are the eigenstates? My eigenstates are the, I can write them as a momentum eigenstate. And what are these? These, I can write this as I exponent I p dot. So let me just work in one dimension for simplicity. Is equal to exponent I p x ket x dx. Right? These are my eigenstates of this Hamiltonian. And then I can take any state and I can write it as some superposition of these eigenstates, right? Like, so these states have a specific momentum, but a general state does not have a specific momentum, right? It's a superposition of different momentum eigenstates. Similarly, these states have a specific spin, but the superposition does not, right? Similarly, if you consider a state like this, then each one of these states individually has a specific angular momentum, total angular momentum, and a orbital this thing as a azimuthal angular momentum, which is the m number, m quantum number. But a superposition of these states will not have any particular angular momenta, right? It will be because it's superposition. So it's exactly the same as, let's say, this situation, right? So this is a particular choice of basis. Now, I don't have to work in this basis, right? So for instance, with this Hamiltonian for the spin 1/2 system over here, I don't have to work with this basis, right? Here, I can always choose a different basis. I can choose a basis, let's say a plus and minus, which is related to the up and down states by, in this way, it's a linear superposition. So the plus state would be 1 by root 2, 1, 1. The minus state would be 1 by root 2, 1 minus 1. Right? So if I work in this basis, this is also an equally valid basis. This is also a complete basis. This is also a complete basis. Both of these are equally valid complete set of basis vectors for my Hilbert space, right? But there is an important difference, which is what? That difference is the fact that these states, in when I work in this basis, my Hamiltonian is diagonal, right? That means these states are eigenvectors of my Hamiltonian. But if I work in this basis, these basis vectors are not eigenvectors of my Hamiltonian, right? So if I ask what are the matrix elements of my Hamiltonian, right? So my Hamiltonian, if I write it as a matrix, it will have four components, which I can write, let's say, as H plus plus, H plus minus, H minus plus, and H minus minus. So for example, where H plus plus is the expectation value, the matrix element of the Hamiltonian in these two plus states, and it's similarly for its plus minus and so on. So if I evaluate this, if I evaluate these quantities, right? So what was my Hamiltonian? My Hamiltonian is just this very simple sigma z matrix, right? And what are my basis states? My basis states are 1 by root 2, 1, plus minus 1. So I can ask, what is my Hamiltonian matrix? Okay. These are my matrix elements. So if I calculate these matrix elements, what will I get? The plus state, the Hamiltonian, then the plus state, right? What will this give me? I'll get 1 by root 2. This is the Hermitian adjoint of the plus state. So I'll get 1. Hamiltonian is 1, 0, 0, minus 1, times 1 by root 2, 1, right? So here I'll just get 2, and 1 minus 1. Now, when I multiply this, what will I get? I'll get 0, right? I'll get 1 minus 1, that's 0. So H plus plus will be 0. What about H plus minus? That will not be 0. In exactly the same way, it will be this 1, 0, 0, minus 1, 1 minus 1. Right? And now what will this be equal to? This will be equal to 1. Let me calculate that. Similarly, H minus plus will be equal to minus 1. Right. I think it should be, yeah. So what is my Hamiltonian matrix in this basis? In this basis, it is 0, 1. It is 0, minus 1, minus 1, 0, like this, right? Whereas if I work in the up, down basis, in the spin basis, my Hamiltonian matrix is diagonal. But here, it is off diagonal, right? It is not diagonal. That's what I want to say. It's not diagonal. Right? So both of these Hamiltonian, both of these matrices represent the same system, right? This is the system with basis state plus and minus. And then this is the system, if I say 0, minus 1, where the basis states are up and down, 1, 0, and 0, 1. So both of these represent the same system, right? Only difference is we are working with a different basis, set of basis vectors here and here. So in one set of basis vectors, my Hamiltonian is diagonal, and in another set, it is not diagonal. Okay. So when I work with the, coming back to angular momentum, right? So how do I make a diagonal basis? I work with basis vectors which are eigenvectors of my Hamiltonian. So coming back to angular momentum, what is the Hamiltonian of a rotating particle? Right? So if you have a particle which is on the surface of a sphere, it is restricted to be on the surface of the sphere and it has some mass m. Its classical Hamiltonian will be what? L square by 2m r square, right? This is the moment of inertia and this is the angular momentum. So the quantum Hamiltonian will be L square by 2m r square. This is the operator, right? So if I say that I'm working in a diagonal basis, right? That would mean that I'm working with states which are eigenvectors of this Hamiltonian, right? And so what are those states? Those states are my eigenvectors of L square, right? And what are those eigenvectors of L square? My L comma M, right? These are my basis vector. And in this basis, what can I say, for instance, about LZ? Well, LZ is also diagonal in this basis, which means that these basis vectors are eigenvectors of this operator. So that is what it means to say, when I use this expression to diagonalize the operators LZ and L square, what I'm saying is that I'm working in with a set of basis vectors in which these operators are diagonal. And why can I pick such a basis? The reason I can pick such a basis is because L square and LZ, they commute. Right? So if they did not commute, then I cannot pick. If two operators commute, then they have the same set of eigenvectors. Right? But if they don't commute, then they don't have the same set of eigenvectors. Right? So if they don't have the same set of eigenvectors, then you can only diagonalize one of those operators, not both of them. Okay. Anyways, I don't know if any of this is making any sense to you all or not. But if you have any questions, please ask. Got it, sir. Okay, great, Priya. All right, so now what I've talked about is, so are these states in terms of which are some functions of theta phi, right? But it is possible to have a different representation of these same operators. So what do we mean by representation? The representation, so for instance, when I write my states like this, this is a certain representation, right? A certain basis. And what are the properties? Properties of these states are that L and M are quantized and they both take integer values, right? But we know that, for instance, that in nature we find particles which have half integer spin, right? So where does this concept of half integer spin come from? Because spin is angular momentum, right? And we have already said that angular momentum eigenstates have integer angular values of integer values of the angular momentum in units of h bar. Right, these are integer values. So one can ask, how can I get something where my angular momentum is not h bar, but 1/2 h bar, right? So let's look at a different way of defining this angular momentum operator. So earlier here, what we said is that our angular momentum operator is r cross p, right? Now, instead of working with these angular momentum operators, we'll work with a slightly different set of angular momentum operators, which are given in terms of the Pauli matrices. Okay. So these are operators which act on functions, right? And you can think of functions as infinite dimensional vectors. So these are infinite dimensional vectors. But what we'll do is we'll talk about this these operators where sigma is the set of Pauli matrices, right? Sigma x, y, and z. Let me write them down again. And as I've said before, it makes a whole lot of difference if you can actually remember the form of these matrices, because they come up again and again and again. So these are my matrices, okay? These are my angular momentum matrices. So you can think of this as being my Lx, this as being my Ly, this as being my Lz. Okay. Well, this multiplied by h bar by 2 is equal to Lx. Then I can ask, what is L square, right? L square is this L dot L, right? So L dot L would be equal to h square by 1 by 4 h square. And then sigma dot sigma would be, I'll get sigma x square plus sigma y square plus sigma z, like this. Okay. And what is sigma x square and sigma y square and sigma z square? Now remember, these are matrices. And the square of all of these matrices, of each one of these three matrices, the square is the identity matrix. So if I take the sum of these three, what do I get? I get 3 by 4. H bar square times the identity matrix, right? So the identity matrix is just 1, 0, 0, 1. So this is my L square operator, 3 by 4 H bar square, right? Now I can ask, So I can write it like this. L square is 3 by 4. H bar square 0, 0, 3 by 4. Now I can ask, what are the eigenvalues of this? It only has one eigenvalue, right? Because the identity matrix only has one eigenvalue, which is 1. Because you can take identity multiplied by any state and you get the same state, where lambda is equal to 1. So what is the eigenvalue of L square? The eigenvalue of L square is 3 by 4 h bar squared. Now this I can write, this expression I can write in this way. H square times 1 half times 1 half plus 1. Okay. So 1 half plus 1 is 3 halves. 3 halves times 1 half is 3 fourths. Right. So I can write this expression in this way. So the eigenvalue of, let me actually, so what is this? If I look at this expression as L square L plus 1, because remember, if you go back here, what are the eigenvalues of my angular momentum operator? They take this form, right? H bar square times L into L plus 1. But here L is a non-negative integer, 0, 1, 2, 3, so forth. Here, what is L? L is 1 half. Right? So L is 1 half. This is half integer, right? So these operators, they describe a spin 1 half. They describe a particle which has angular momentum, which is h bar by 2. And why do these, the question is, why do these operators describe, have anything to do with angular momentum? Because, well, you remember that these operators, Lx, Ly, and Lz, and L square, they satisfy certain algebra, right? What is that algebra? According to this angular momentum algebra, L square commutes with all of the individual operators. And if I take the commutator of any two of these components, I get the third component. So if I take the commutator of Lx and Ly, I get Lz and so on, right? That is the algebra of these operators, right? And when I want to understand the eigenvalues and so on, right, I don't have to work with any particular representation of these operators. For instance, I don't have to assume that these operators are given by some, in terms of some Laplacian operator or its angular momentum part, right? I don't have to worry about all of that. Why? Because I can just look at the algebra. I can construct the L plus minus operators. And just like in the case of the simple harmonic oscillator, say only from the algebra, I can derive this. I can derive the complete set of eigenvalues, right? So from the algebra only, I get the complete set of eigenvalues. That L can be a non-negative integer and that M has to be minus L, between minus N and plus L, right? Now these states satisfy these properties, right? When the angular momentum operators are written in terms of these derivatives, right? D by d theta, d by d phi, right? But the main property of the angular momentum operator is this algebra. So what if I look at the algebra of these matrices? Right, sigma x, y, z, and sigma squared. Sigma squared is what? It's the identity. Well, it's actually 3 times the identity, right? It's the sum of sigma x squared, sigma y squared, sigma y z squared. So I get 3 times the identity. So if I ask what is the angle, the algebra, well, sigma I squared commutes with all of the individual sigma I, right? And if I take the commutator of any two of these matrices, what do I get? I get the third matrix. So if I take the commutator of sigma X and sigma Y, I get sigma Z, right? Similarly, if I take commutator of sigma Y and Z, I get sigma X and so on. Okay, but to get this, actually, what you have to do is you have to work with, you have to divide by 1/2. So this actually becomes sigma. So if I look at these operators satisfy this problem. If I don't put this 1/2 over here, then here I will get a factor of 2. That's the only thing. So if I define my matrices in this way, so let me just put that factor of 1/2. So with this factor of 1/2, these operators, now they satisfy exactly the same algebra as my angular momentum operator. Right? So there is this expression, right? If it walks like a duck, and it talks like a duck, then it's a duck, right? So if it walks like angular momentum, and it talks like angular momentum, then it's angular momentum. So these also represent angular momenta. But angular momenta of what? Of a spin 1/2 particle. Okay. So I think I'll stop here today. Since there's not much enthusiasm today. All right. Are there any questions? Okay. All right. Then I'll stop the recording.